Now we will discuss the applied anatomy related to the larynx. The larynx can be visualized directly with the help of an instrument laryngoscope. This procedure is the direct laryngoscopy. Here we can visualize the true and the false vocal cords. The true vocal cords, they will appear pearly white in color as they lack capillaries, while the false vocal cords, they lie outer to the true cords and they appear pinkish in color. We can also visualize epiglottis, aryepiglottic folds, arytenoid cartilages covered with the mucosa with this procedure. Larynx can also be visualized with the help of a laryngeal mirror, and this procedure is known as the indirect laryngoscopy. But while doing the laryngoscopy, one must be very careful in infants, as in infants, the larynx is lying at a higher level as compared to the adults. The epiglottis in the infants is lying at the level of second or first cervical vertebra, and also the cartilages of the larynx, they are very soft, and vocal cords, they are also short and they are slanting anteriorly in infants. So these levels of epiglottis and the larynx, they must be remembered while doing the laryngoscopy. Normally, the foreign bodies, they cannot enter into the cavity of the larynx as the laryngeal mucosa is very sensitive. And if a foreign body touches the laryngeal inlet, a strong cough reflex is generated and this will expel the foreign body out of the laryngeal cavity. But sometimes in some neurological lesions or in children, the foreign body may accidentally enter into the cavity of the larynx and this must be immediately removed as this foreign body can block the entry of air into the lower respiratory passages. Asphyxia, cyanosis, or choking of the person can occur. And to remove this foreign body, we can immediately do a life-saving procedure, that is the Heimlich's maneuver. In this maneuver, we stand behind the patient and try to give strong abdominal thrust. And these strong abdominal thrust will push the residual air present in the lungs forcefully through the trachea and the larynx. And this forceful passage of the air can also remove the foreign body out of the larynx. But if this procedure fails, one may have to give an incision in the cricothyroid membrane to maintain the patent airways. And this procedure is known as the cricothyrotomy. Another way to maintain the patency of the air passages is the tracheostomy. Here an incision is given in the trachea and a small tube is put through this incision. Tracheostomy is usually a permanent type of procedure mostly done in the patients of neurological lesions or in vocal cord paralysis or in tumors of the vocal cords when the air entry to the lower respiratory passages is blocked. Lesions can also occur in the vocal cords in the form of nodules. These vocal nodules, they are also known as the teachers or singers nodules, as they are mostly found in teachers or singers who use their vocal cords excessively. And these vocal nodules, they usually form at the junction of anterior one-third and posterior two-third of the vocal cords, as this area is subjected to maximum friction during the phonation. And minor hemorrhages in the submucosa and fibrosis occur, resulting in formation of these nodules. And due to the vocal nodules, patient may complain of hoarseness, vocal fatigue, or the pain. Vocal cord paralysis can also occur, but before discussing the vocal cord paralysis, we must know the vocal cord positions normally during the phonations and the respiration. During the phonation, as we see in this first diagram, both the vocal cords, they lie in median or slightly adducted position, and a very narrow gap is present between the two vocal cords, both in the intermembranous and intercartilaginous part. While during the normal respiration, there is a slight abduction present between the two vocal cords, both the intermembranous and intercartilaginous parts, they are slightly open. So these are the two normal positions, and we can now compare it with this first diagram. During the phonation, this position is known as the median position, and in the inspiration, this is the slightly abduction position. The third position, which is present in the vocal cord paralysis, this is the cadaveric position, where or neutral position. This is the position from where abduction or adduction movement will start. fourth position in the vocal cord can be slightly away from the midline, that is the paramedian position. Now we will discuss about the paralysis of the vocal cord due to injuries to either to the superior laryngeal or recurrent laryngeal nerve. First, due to the injuries to the superior laryngeal nerve, which can happen due to the during the surgeries in the thyroid gland or due to some neuritis. Now, superior laryngeal nerve, it is having two branches, external and internal laryngeal nerve. The external laryngeal nerve, it supplies the cricothyroid muscle, a tensor of the vocal cord, while internal laryngeal nerve, it supplies the mucosa above the vocal folds. Now, if the superior laryngeal nerve of one side is injured, this will result in paralysis of the cricothyroid muscle of that side, resulting in the relaxation or a lax vocal cord. But this type of injury usually goes unnoticed and voice will be just weak, and this is mostly noticed in the singers when the pitch cannot be raised. Otherwise, patient will not have any problem. But if the both sides of sided injury to the superior laryngeal nerve is there, which can happen during the thyroid surgery, there will be paralysis of cricothyroid muscle on both the sides. And both the vocal cords, they will be lying loose and lax. But more problem is because of the complete anesthesia of the larynx above the vocal cords. And this can cause the aspiration of the fluids, as the now laryngeal mucosa cannot generate a cough reflex. Injury to the recurrent laryngeal nerve will cause paralysis of all muscles of the larynx except the cricothyroid muscles. So both the abductors and adductors, they will be injured. But according to the Simmons law, abductor fibers, they will be more involved as compared to the adductor fibers. That means the vocal cords, they cannot move to the abducted position. Now, if the injury is unilateral, that is only one-sided recurrent laryngeal nerve is involved, and it is mostly the left recurrent laryngeal is involved. In these conditions, here we can see in this diagram, this is the paralyzed side. The vocal cord here will lie in the median or paramedian position. It cannot abduct from this position. But the normal respiration is possible in these patients, as the normal vocal cord, it can move to the abducted position and airways can be maintained. But the voice will also gradually improve in these patients, as the normal vocal cord during the phonation, it will move to cross the midline and move to the opposite side. And now both the vocal cords, they appear to be in adducted position and phonation is possible. But if the injury is bilateral, that is both the recurrent laryngeal nerves, they are involved. Now both the vocal cords, they will lie in median or paramedian position, or they will lie close to each other and abduction cannot be done. And here the air passages, they cannot be maintained and patient will have dyspnea or stridor. And in these patients, to maintain the air passages, tracheostomy has to be done. So unilateral injuries of the recurrent laryngeal nerve, they will not cause much problem, as the normal phonation as well as normal respiration is possible. During the phonation, the normal vocal cord will cross the midline to meet the paralyzed vocal cord. And bilateral injuries, tracheostomy may has to be done, as the air entry is blocked. So this is about the paralysis of the vocal cords in superior laryngeal nerve injuries or recurrent laryngeal nerve injuries. And now, if both the recurrent and the superior laryngeal nerves, they are involved, the position of the vocal cord, it will be a cadaveric position. This cadaveric position is the neutral position from which abduction or adduction it starts. Now, since both the nerves, they are involved, both abductors and adductors are involved, and now the vocal cords, they are in cadaveric position, and moreover the anesthesia is there of the vocal of the larynx, so aphonia, aspiration and inability to cough and bronchopneumonia is there, and tracheostomy has to be done in these patients also. Now, sometimes carcinomas can also occur in the larynx, and these carcinomas, they can be supraglottic, glottic or subglottic. The glottic carcinomas or the carcinoma of the vocal cords, they are more common and they are more easily diagnosed, as changes in the voice occur early. बी कार्सिनोमा लैरिंग्स दे आर मोर कॉमन इन मेल्स एज टोबैको एंड अल्कोहल दे आर द रिस्क फैक्टर्स इन द लैरिंजियल कार्सिनोमास. Now, laryngoceles, they can also form in the saccule of the larynx. As we have already studied, this saccule is the part of the laryngeal cavity, part of the sinus of the larynx, which is extending outward. And these laryngoceles, they can be internal laryngoceles or external laryngoceles. When they are lying internal to the thyroid membrane, they may not cause a swelling over the neck. But if they pierce the thyroid membrane, they can cause a swelling in the neck. As external laryngoceles, subhyoid bursitis can occur because of the inflammation of the bursa, which is in the subhyoid position between the hyoid bone and the thyroid membrane, and they can present as midline swellings in the neck. So this is about the applied anatomy related to the larynx, and this completes the topic of the larynx, commonly known as the voice box. And skeleton of the larynx, it is made up of the cartilages, joints, ligaments, and membranes, and the muscles.